There's a big difference between being busy and being productive, right? People just think because they're like busy doing, you know, random things, that's like moving the needle. But a lot of times that's not.
Welcome to Empowerista, a show dedicated to helping you show up and be seen as an entrepreneur. I'm your host, Alex Worley, the CEO of Empowerista, an award-winning producer and national TV host, seen on platforms like Entrepreneur.com, Amazon Prime, and Business Rockstars. These are the tips and truths to amplify your influence and income. My guest today is Jennifer Cohen, a best-selling author, performance coach, and host of Habits and Hustle, one of the fastest-rising, regularly-ranked podcasts helping listeners level up their physical and mental capabilities. She's also a wife and mom of two residing in Los Angeles. During our conversation, we discuss how to manage and balance your time, go after your goals, and take charge as a woman. Before we dive in, I wanted to let you know I'm currently booking clients for Confidently on Camera, a 12-week one-on-one coaching program with me empowering you to plan, present, produce, promote, and publish your first social media video series to ultimately increase your influence and income online. If you're interested in learning more, apply for a free consultation at confidentlyoncamera.com to see if working together is a good fit. Thanks so much for being here.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah.
I love the studio. It's really professional and nice. It's
great. Oh, well, thank
you.
No,
you're welcome.
Coming from you, media expert, means a lot.
Well, thank you. That's too kind. That's too kind.
Well, I'm really excited for myself to get to know your journey because I think you're such a good example of being a multi-passionate entrepreneur and how that all comes together. You have a beautiful personal brand and have done a lot. So if you could just start by giving us an overview of all the various things that you've done as an entrepreneur.
Oh, right. That's a big question. So I guess I started my career mostly in the fitness space, right? I was in the music space. I was a music executive for many years. And I really one day decided to follow my passion, which was always, I loved working out, always have. And I thought, you know, why don't I just become a personal trainer in the interim of kind of figuring out what I can do? And that's what I did. And I kind of created my passion into my profession, really. I became a label trainer. So I went to record labels and made deals with record labels. And then just started building my brand in the fitness space. And over the years, it morphed and evolved into creating No Gym Required, which was the name of my first book, but also the name of a shoe company, my first company, which was a weighted shoe. And then I sold it, and then wrote another book, Strong as a New Skinny, and then created a fitness app, which then I sold to Weight Watchers. And I've been kind of just like, I've been doing a lot of like entrepreneurial, I've been doing a lot of business stuff in the health and fitness space with between my writing and the companies I've built with other people, and now with the podcast being kind of like the next evolution. So it's really morphed between going from fitness to productivity, motivation, personal development. There's so much, they all dovetail each other, right? Because fitness is a big part of self-care and personal development, that it kind of is just kind of par for the course, that you evolve and you grow as you keep on working in this. And that's basically in a nutshell. I've obviously left out a lot.
My big question. Yeah. No, for sure.
But,
and I think that there are so many people who want to do so many things, and now you're a high performance coach as well among the various things
right.
that you do. What advice would you give yourself when you were first starting out and had a hand in so many things when it comes to becoming clear on what it is that you do?
So that's a good question. And like I'm going to kind of contradict myself at the same time as my answer here, but I feel like you have to pick a lane, right? Like you can't be everything to everyone. But at the same time, you need to try a lot of things to know what your lane is, right? So I think you take advantage of opportunities that you have when you're young and dabble in a lot of things, but then find something that you truly are passionate with and build in that space? Because I feel like a lot of times, like entrepreneurs, they're kind of like scattered and all over the place, and they're high level thinkers, so they want to do this, they want to do that. But the ones who truly succeed, and I found this, is when you really kind of like, you like deep dive into one spot and you really kind of build and you just keep on going in that area. And from there, then you can also then expand. But, you know, like to answer your question, I guess it is like try a lot of things and then really narrow that focus down at a concise, finite period of time and like dig in.
Yeah. So what's an example for you where you chose a lane, went all in, and it really came into fruition for you?
So that would be when I chose my lane, when I left music to be in the fitness space. And then I realized, you know, fitness is a very vast business. It's huge, right? There's so many different like niches. But I really, really kind of felt my philosophy fit the whole idea of not using a gym, even though I like the gym. But the whole idea of like no gym required is that it's healthy ways to stay fit and healthy without needing a gym. So it's like how to like work at home workouts, things that you can do when you travel. And that was really my lane, was all about no gym required. And that's why my first company ever was called that, and my first book was called that. Because, you know, I wanted to give people, especially like people like new moms, people who are traveling, take away the excuse factor of oh, I can't do this, oh, I can't do that. And that was really what I felt like people were using as an excuse not to be healthier or not to get more strong. And I guess that was really my lane. And then it kind of like grew from there. But
yeah, you became known for something specific because the fitness industry is really large.
Really
some
large.
Some would say saturated. But when you can make it smaller and help an audience in a really specific, deep way, then you can create loyal, raving fans, because there was probably an untapped market in a saturated industry where they wanted the no gym.
Right. Well, it's funny because like now it's beyond saturated. Like everything now is like fitness, and like the craze has become like monstrous, right? But I guess like not to age myself, but I'm going to right now. But the truth of the matter is when I started, yeah, fitness was popular, but it wasn't like it is now. It was not even close to what it was now. And so actually no gym required as like a tagline has become more popular now than it ever was back then.
You're on the forefront.
I kind of like, yeah, I create, want not to like, you know, pat myself on the back.
You can pat
yourself
on the back.
Not at all. But I kind of like, I built something before it was even a trend, you know? And then, you know, unfortunately, like maybe I didn't reap the same benefits I would have if I created it now in a way, but that was really my first lane. And then I kind of morphed into that, okay, now my philosophy really is about not needing a gym. But what's my other philosophy? My other philosophy that I really stand behind for women especially is get away from that whole skinny concept. That always bothered me. It was like that was the through line in my first book, and that was the through line in my second book, was that not everybody can be super skinny, but everybody could be strong. So give people a goal and give people a positive thing that they can work towards that is attainable for anybody. Not just something that's like, okay, if I'm a size 4, I want to be a size 2. If I'm a size 2, I want to be a size... Like that whole idea and concept really bothered me. And so I felt like at the time that when I wrote Strong is the New Skinny, it was a really good message and a good baseline for people to try to achieve, right? And so, again, everyone can get stronger and stronger. And like that was like how, that was like the new lane that I was really kind of in, right?
Yeah, what I love about what you're talking about is whether you're in a crowded space or not, because I think there's always room for new people. When you have a new take and a new point of view, and you had such a specific point of view, mm-hmm. and that really, really came through.
Yeah, and I was like super, it was authentic and I was passionate about it. And I think you need that authenticity to really kind of push something, because 99% of something is what they say is like perspiration, 99% is perspiration and 1% is what the
inspiration. Maybe?
Yeah. Because you need to really kind of like, if you believe in something, especially for people who are starting a business or have like a message that they want to get out there, you have to be 110% behind it for it to be successful, or else anything just wanes and falls to the wayside. And then from that, it kind of morphed and evolved into, okay, you know, like to be strong, to be fit, to be healthy, like what does that really mean? And really what it means is building habits that are healthy and positive, and routines that are healthy and positive. And that really has been the way that I've built my career, is really knowing my pitfalls and then structuring around it. Because that's a big thing. I think everyone has like their things that they're like are like kind of like their Achilles heel, and then there are things that they are really good with. So know what your Achilles heels are, or your heel is, and then build build a structure to kind of like help with those. So building routines and habits that are, like I said, keep you in the positive and productivity and all that other stuff.
Yeah. So as an entrepreneur, for you, what have been those habits that have really moved you forward?
Having a very strong morning routine and a very strong night routine, because you can't have a really good morning routine if you have a really bad.
We'll keep it PG.
Very PG night routine, and because that puts you in a place to win. So that was how I started. So I had like habits where like make sure in the morning before I even get out of bed to have a glass of water. That way I'm going to be, you know, that kind of puts me on the path of hydration. I knew I hated to drink water, but water is like an essential part of being hydrated, blah, blah. Make sure I get a certain amount of sleep every night, which goes to my night routine. Make sure that I've had the same breakfast, actually, since I was like, I don't know, 21 years old.
And what is that breakfast?
And I mean, it's nothing fancy, but like I know, it's like it's basically eggs and a grapefruit and coffee and peppermint tea. Now, it's very boring, right? But I wanted to put certain things on autopilot as soon as I could in the morning to keep my brain able to like focus on other things.
It's kind of like Mark Zuckerberg wears the same thing every day, so
right,
he doesn't
exactly
have to think about what to wear.
Or like Steve Jobs did that, and like, yeah. I mean, kind of the same thing. Like why put energy into something that A is not that important in the grand scheme? And for me, I do love food, and so I don't want to start my day off with having, and I'm having pancakes, all these things that will kind of make me tired and feel bad about me. You know, have something that's healthy and good so then I can, like, you know, not even think about it and, like, move on with my day. So, like, certain things like that. And so I believe that to be successful, you need to put certain structures, routines, habits in place and follow them to kind of be the best version of yourself. And so that's how everything's kind of evolved. And now with my podcast, Habits and Hustle, I'm sure you understand, like it's all about the habits and rituals of people who are super successful, huge thought leaders, iconic figures, because I do believe from good to great, you need that. And everyone has these like quirky, weird things that they do. And I wanted to kind of like, you know, kind of figure out what they were and see if how other people can maybe use them or integrate them. And when I work with my own private clients, it's about that also. If they don't have a really strong routine, helping them build a routine. And
And I know that you are very, very keen on time management. So through your own experience and through the entrepreneurs, thought leaders that you've interviewed, what are some time management tips that you can
give us? Oh, time management. Oh, gosh. Time management is key, first of all. I don't love, to be honest, I'll tell you one of my big ones is take as few meetings as possible, right? Like manage that space, because I feel like a lot of times people take like a ton of meetings and they're usually arbitrary. You could have done it on the phone, right? But the amount of time to get to the meeting, to sit in the meeting, to get back from the meeting, and the meeting a lot of times a lot of like fluff, right? Where if you can put it, kind of put together like a task sheet and just have a call, you condense that time and it's much more productive and much more valuable than just like yammering on and on for hours and hours on end in a meeting and then go to another meeting. So that's one of them.
Yeah, and I read that you're all about being a goal-getter, and I think when you approach it from that perspective, mm-hmm. that what are my goals and what are the tasks and how can I use my time to move the needle on
yes.
those goals, you start to realize that there are so many things that we do in a day that don't move the needle at all
oh,
and
absolutely.
Are actually not important.
Well, it's funny. I think that's what I call it, reverse engineering, whatever it is, right? So figure out where you want to be and then the steps, you know, backwards to get there. But yeah, there's a big difference between being busy and being productive, right? People just think because they're like busy doing, you know, random things, that's like moving the needle. But a lot of times that's not. That's a lot of times it's procrastination. You're procrastinating by doing the things that you need to do, by like doing a lot of like busy work, right? And so what I try to tell people I work with and what I try to stand by, and it's, believe me, it's not as easy as, you know, I can say it and then it's a work in progress, but try to get the hardest tasks done first thing, because that way it's out of the way and then otherwise they're going to be like lingering and lingering.
And weighing you down.
And weighing you down. And you're thinking about it all the time. So like use your, that's again like about the morning routines, like using your time wisely, you know, like starting off on the right foot, getting some key little positive things that, you know, journaling. A lot of people like to like journal or use a gratitude journal in the mornings. And then get to like the actual stuff that's kind of weighing you in your brain, and we all have them, and like get them over with. Do them first thing.
Yeah, absolutely.
Hey, super quick, if this episode is inspiring you, don't forget to subscribe to the podcast. I release new episodes every week, same time, same place. And in case you missed it, I'm currently booking clients for Confidently On Camera, a one-on-one coaching program with me, empowering you to plan, present, produce, promote, and publish your first social media video series to ultimately increase your influence and income online. If you're interested in learning more, apply for a free consultation at confidentlyoncamera.com to see if working together is a good fit.
Yeah.
So there are a lot of people who are trying to build personal brands.
Right.
So since you have successfully, what do you think is the key to building a personal brand?
Well, I think authenticity is very important. And like I said earlier, I think is staying in one area. Don't try to be everything to everyone. Just find your audience by being authentic and doing something in a niche, you know, like in that space, in an area. Pick the area you like to be involved with and then pick a niche within that area and be authentic. And we were talking off camera before about like social media. You know, there's a lot of pressure. And I mean, it's very difficult, especially with I have two kids, I have a husband, I have like, you know, it's very, very hard. You have this extra layer of pressure sometimes about being a personality of sorts on social media and posting all the time. And, you know, that can weigh you down. And I think that a lot of people like are so concerned about like how many followers they have, how many likes they have, how much. And by the way, I hope they get away with those likes very fast.
Yeah.
I heard they are. And
yeah,
like,
I heard that's for sure happening.
I heard so. And meanwhile, every day I'm looking, I'm like, no.
Nope. On Instagram. Yeah.
Still
exactly.
there. And now every day there's like another platform that appears. Like,
it's hard to keep up.
It's super hard. Like now I'm mostly only on Instagram because I don't have the bandwidth to be on Facebook and to be on Twitter and to be on Instagram. And now everyone's coming to me. They're like, well, are you on TikTok? What are you doing on TikTok? And I'm like, I have nothing to do on TikTok. Like, I don't even know what to do on TikTok, but like you could, like each one of those mediums is a full-time job. Right?
I know. And some people do have full-time employees to run all the different mediums.
Don't be mistaken. I think that most people, especially like, I mean, every celebrity, like, and if they say they don't, they're lying to you. They have like a team of people who do it. I mean, mm-hmm. if you really think
Or at least help. Yeah.
If you really think J-Lo is like on her Instagram, like, you know, basically posting and tweeting and it not happening, you know? And they may look and like have some like involvement. But it's like literally, like legit, it's like a full-time job. So, You know, I think that that can bog somebody down too. So like, I think you're going to put like a time limit on how much you're spending on that daily, right?
Because yeah, I'd love to know what your philosophy is, because it is this fine balance between not letting it consume your life,
right?
But at the same time, if you've chosen the business model of being a media personality where you're the face of your brand, it's important. So where do you draw the line? Do you have any guidelines as far as like, this is really important to me to show up, whether it's X amount of times or just making sure that you're serving your audiences in a certain way, and this is where you feel like it doesn't matter?
Well, I actually think that I do that part very poorly. I'm like very about like just throw a lot of crap at the wall and see what sticks. I have no strategy when it comes to my social media, which is probably not such a great thing. I actually do post myself, and because of that, like, I don't have time to make every picture look pretty and to write like a beautiful, you know, caption. So it looks like a 7-year-old did it, because I did it, right? And so it doesn't look very nice. But so what I like to post myself is, you know, like I post a lot of stuff on fitness, because I know that people, like, that's something that actually people could like do. That I can do it and people could then follow along, or they could see it and try it themselves. That's majority. So I just like post videos of me like exercising, or I post a lot of things on my podcast, which are hopefully, and I hope it is, but like inspiring people or giving people some takeaways that they can implement into their lives. So I don't do a lot with like family stuff. I don't do a lot with
nothing personal. You just kind of stay in your lane.
I do stay in my lane. I mean, I do like I said, like a lot of like business leadership stuff or fitness stuff. Now, I don't do family stuff also, because I don't really, why, right? Like, that's not what I do. I do those things, and like sometimes I'll pepper in something with a picture of me and my kids or my husband, but it's not really the forefront, right? But it is a big part of people's brands. And I mean, like I said, I'm not going to sit here and be like, oh, I'm so great at it, because I'm like not. So,
well, I've seen your social media and I would disagree. I think you are good at it, and you have built a big audience. So I am curious, if you feel like social media hasn't been your secret sauce, what do you feel like has been your secret sauce to building an audience and to establishing yourself as a media personality?
Well, first of all, I think that what I do well, that's helped me a lot, is the networking. I'm a good networker. I put myself in situations and put myself in opportunities where I'll meet a lot of other people and then leverage a lot from their audience, leverage a lot from their business context. And it's very much reciprocal. When I meet with people, I give everything. So like, I don't hoard. Like, if I can help somebody in any way, I do it anytime. I'll introduce you to anybody I know. I'll help you anywhere. I'll guide someone anywhere. And I think that comes back to you tenfold.
Absolutely.
Right? So I feel like that has been a really big part of my growth, is that I've done that a lot for other people. And then in return, they've done that for me. Not in return like that, but even a lot of times the people who I've helped have never helped me. It's not about that, but I put that out there. And I think that building a really good network, putting yourself in places where you could meet key people or network and build your community is very, very important. And like, if it translates, and it does most of the time on social media, great. So like with social media, I've grown a lot of my base probably is because my last book was called Badass Body Goals. I did a lot of collaborations with a lot of health, beauty, fashion people who I did them with were really good entrepreneurs. And so they helped promote me. I helped promote them. And, you know, it was like we become like very good friends. So my network has grown a lot online and offline. So a lot of the people I deal with are not even on Instagram, social media, but they've helped elevate my business in other ways. So I think, you know, that's one, networking, and not be so myopic. Like, think way bigger than just over here. Just because someone you don't think can help you don't think that they don't know 10 people who can. And I think a lot of people say no when they should be saying yes. And I've seen that a lot. Like, people are like, hey, do you want to do this? I'm like, oh, no. They're like, no, it's too small, or I don't want that, or I don't know. And the reality is, like, you never know what opportunity can come from that, you know, that if you just said yes. So many times, like I said, a lot of my really good places of growth and opportunity came from places and people that I never thought would be able to ever do that. And the people I put a lot of, like, you know, I put a lot of, like, stock into, people who are huge names, did nothing for my business or for my personal brand. Nothing.
Yeah, you know? That's so interesting. And you've done so many admirable things. I've been on big national shows, given a TED Talk. You're a best-selling author. I mean, so the list goes on. And would you say even those big accolades, a lot of it is because of the time? Well, obviously, your hard work first and foremost, your expertise.
Right, right.
But as far as taking it to that next level, networking?
Networking, and part of that networking is asking for what you want. So my entire TED Talk, which I just did a few months ago, was really about the secret to getting anything you want. And the truth of the matter is, it's when you, no matter who you're talking to, ask for what you want. People don't ask for what they actually want. And so, therefore, they don't get what they want. They default to what's available, or they acquiesce to what's around them. But they're not being specific, again, on, like, asking the question for what they actually want. And the truth is, most of the time, when you ask for what you want, even if you don't get what you asked for, you will get another opportunity that you never even knew existed. And so I think going out there asking for what you want is extremely important to growing your business and to elevating your personal brand in everything, and also in personal, right? People just don't want to ask. I think they say, like, the statistic is, most people don't even ask for what they, not even asking once. You know, like, was it like 90% of people don't even ask for what they want at all? And 10% even, and they ask, they'll only ask one time. So my entire thing is, if you ask, make 10 attempts at whatever you want. So don't just ask one time, one person, and then be like, all right, well, I never got it. Well, okay, well, ask 9 more attempts. Like, maybe
sometimes it's a numbers game.
It is. It's volume. Everything is volume, right? Like, you know, it's like people, when they're dating, it's volume, right?
Yeah,
like,
sure.
You ask 20 people out, 10 people out, one will say yes eventually.
You only need one.
You only need one, right?
Yeah.
But, like, and it's like taking that opportunity and building on it. But it's all about, like, asking for what you want and not just taking no as the answer, but, like, being comfortable with the failure, getting comfortable with the resilience of having to ask over and over again, or making 10 attempts at it. And so I think between that, networking, and then asking for what you want is the secret sauce.
What's something that you're really glad you asked for in your business, or just throughout your entrepreneurship journey?
Oh, God, my God. Every day I ask for, like, 100 things. I don't even know at what point. I think when I went to the record labels initially and asked to be a label trainer, which didn't even exist back then, and just creating a position for myself, I think I'll even give you an example from recently, like my podcast, Habits and Hustle. You know, the truth of the matter is, I never thought in a million years I would be doing a podcast. It just didn't seem like a platform that I was going to do. And then I basically just said, okay, I made a commitment to do it, and then I asked people to like do it with me and partner with me, like Entrepreneur Magazine, and like now a year later, here we are doing it, and it's doing really well, and we have great guests, and it's like opened up an entire new world of interesting people and opportunity that I never even knew existed.
Yeah, that's a really good point, because I think a lot of times people are seeing these influencers partnering with these various brands, and they're just assuming the brands are coming to them.
Oh, God, no.
No, these influencers, thought leaders, the majority of them have to be proactive and reach out to these influential people, brands, to see if they want to collaborate.
Absolutely.
You're a great example of that. And
I would say 9 out of 10 of the brands I've ever worked with is because I went after them.
Yeah.
They didn't just go after me. It's not that easy. To get a corporation to partner with you, it's like they can be with anybody. Why would they? Like, how do they know about you? Unless, like I said, unless you're like a J-Lo or a Kim Kardashian. It doesn't happen like that. You have to be extremely proactive. And that goes to my point, asking for what you want and being very, very specific, going after a brand that you think really coincides with your messages, and then tell them how much you love their brand and why you want to work with them, and how you see this partnership.
And where can people keep up with you?
They can find me at The Real Jen Cohen on Instagram, on Facebook. They can also go check out my podcast, Habits and Hustle, which is part of, it's obviously on iTunes, it's Spotify, Stitch, wherever you find a local, wherever you find your podcast, or my website, jennifercohen.com.
Awesome. Jennifer, thank you so much for your time today.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure.
Well, that's it for today's show. If you're loving this podcast, don't forget to subscribe so we can meet again next week, same time, same place. Thank you so much for listening, and have an amazing week.